C4 and Bryan Nehman.
WBAL News Radio 1090, FM 101.5, and the WBAL radio app.
You know, it was July 15th, 2011, when Lawrence J. Hogan Jr. came into studio with me, Bryan Nehman, and audience, and talked about an organization that he had created called Change Maryland. He was the CEO. And how he was going around talking to business people about how Marylanders were paying too much in taxes, were overtaxed, overtold, overfeed, and how there was a pathway to begin to have a national discussion about the migration of folks leaving Maryland. Who knew that several years later, in 2014, he would win the Republican primary for governor and then become the first two-term governor that's a Republican in the state of Maryland since Taz? I mean, Governor Larry Hogan joins us here in studio as we talk with you. First of all, Happy New Year and good morning, Governor Hogan.
Well, thank you, C4. Bryan, it's great to be here with you. Happy New Year to you guys. I'm excited to be here. That was a long time ago. Wow. That's 12 years, 12 and a half years ago when I came in. You actually talked to me back then.
Yeah. And we're going to talk a lot about what's happening in the interim, but let's begin with your swearing in January 21st, 2015, when you became governor of the state of Maryland, Governor Hogan. And first of all, what were your anticipations? What did you see coming in, knowing you were going to deal with the adversarial legislature, and what did you want to try to accomplish?
Well, you know, I remember that day like it was yesterday. It's amazing that 8 years, it really seems like it went by pretty fast. Although in some other ways, it seems like dog years.
Right.
Seems like forever.
We all have aged like that.
Yeah, I've aged a lot. When I came in, I knew we had a big challenge ahead of us. At that point, our state was ranked 49th out of 50 states in economic performance. You know, our economy had been crushed. We lost all of the businesses, jobs, and taxpayers were fleeing. And I decided I was going to try to do something about it. That's what I was talking with you about for a couple of years on Change Maryland. And then I came in with the expectation that I was a Republican in the bluest state in America with a 70% Democratic legislature, but that I was going to try to figure out a way to work together to solve problems. I said it wasn't going to be the beginning of divided government, but the beginning of an era of bipartisan cooperation. And that's, so we did exactly what we said we would do. We cut taxes 8 years in a row by $4.7 billion. We took a $5 billion deficit and turned it into a $5 billion surplus, the biggest in state history. And we went from 49th out of 50 states to number six. It was the biggest economic turnaround in America. So I feel, at coming to the end of the term here, it's what I've been talking about really for more than 12 years when I founded Change Maryland. And it's what I've been focused on every day for 8 years that we've, it doesn't usually happen in politics, but I think we've done exactly what we said we would do.
8 years is a long time. Do you have a proudest achievement? Is there something that you look back and you say, man, I can't believe we did that, or I'm really glad that got done?
Well, I think that what I just said is the proudest achievement because it's what motivated me to start the organization Change Maryland. It's why I ran for governor. I said, I'm going to try to turn our economy around. I'm going to try to help small businesses mm-hmm. grow and put more people to work. And after 43 tax hikes in a row, I said, we're going to stop that and we're going to reverse that. So we didn't have a single tax increase for 8 years. And we cut taxes every single year by $4.7 billion. The fact that we took this, the largest deficit in history and turned it into the largest surplus in history and went from one of the worst economies in the country to one of the best. I mean, I'm proud of a lot of things that we accomplished, but the overall arching thing was that was the mission. That was what we were focused on. It's what I promised to do, and that's what we got done. And you couldn't have gone any better.
Maryland Governor Larry Hogan is joining us in studio. One of the last interviews we will have with you as governor of the state. I look forward to having many more once you leave the governor's office, talk about your future. But we do need to go back to April the 25th, that weekend, going into April 27th of 2015, when this brand new governor, fresh off his first session, had to deal with the major city of his state in flames, on national television, riots. You had to make decisions, Governor Hogan, not only to how to quell the riot, but you also said, I want to bring my office, my people, physically to Baltimore. Talk about that weekend, the 25th and 27th, when you basically had to come in and assist Mayor Stephanie Rawlings-Blake in bringing order to the city.
Yeah, it was, we came in with all these things we were going to focus on. The first session, we repealed the rain tax. We started cutting taxes. We started laying out our agenda. But then, of course, you get hit with things that you're not planning for, like the worst violence in 47 years that broke out in our largest city. And, the city was in flames and hundreds of businesses and homes were looted and burned and destroyed, and police cars were on fire. We had 130 police and firefighters injured and hospitalized. It was, you know, a really tough situation. And, I immediately declared a state of emergency. I sent in 4,000 members of the Maryland National Guard, 1,000 additional state police and other surrounding jurisdiction police officers, and more firefighters from other jurisdictions. And I went into the city immediately myself, into the burning city, brought our entire cabinet and our entire team, and we stayed here for a week.
Mm-hmm.
We allowed for the peaceful protest, but we stopped all the violence immediately. And I walked the streets for a solid week, meeting with community leaders and faith leaders and hugging people who had their businesses burned out. And,
even shot a little hoops.
Yeah, and reassuring people, you know, that it was going to be okay. And I went to Freddie Gray's neighborhood and talked to some of the friends and neighbors and actually shot some basketball and walked around.
You even made a couple, didn't you?
Well, I might have sunk a three-pointer. I'm not sure. So one of my prouder moments was the Washington Post did a piece about me being there. And they said, one of the kids I was shooting with says, the governor can shoot for real.
For real.
And I was like, that's one of the better, you know, not like he did a great job on this or that, but I still had street cred. I still got skills, you know, after all these years. So,
but all the time after Freddie Gray, we still have 330 murders a year here in Baltimore. It never got better. Why do you think it has been such a struggle when it comes to violent crime in Baltimore? And do you wish there any kind of regrets or look back and say, maybe we could have done this better?
Well, the two major regrets that I have leaving are that, we haven't figured out a way with the city leaders of Baltimore to do something about the violent crime, and that we, in spite of tremendous effort, haven't been able to fix the broken schools either. And not for lack of trying, but Baltimore City, you know, I'm not the mayor of Baltimore, and I can't make those decisions. And but I sure did try. We put you know, over $1 billion into more public safety in Baltimore City. We put together groups of federal, state, and local leaders coming in there to do sweeps. We provided Baltimore City with every single thing that they ever asked for. The biggest thing was we pushed for tougher sentences mm-hmm. for these repeat violent offenders, and tougher sentences for people that commit felonies with a gun. And this is something that's overwhelmingly popular. Almost 90% of the people in Baltimore agree with that legislation. 80-some percent of the people statewide agree with the legislation, and yet we passed some of it through the Senate, but not the House. And it was primarily the leaders in Baltimore fighting against us because they didn't want to do that. So stopping the crime, the violent crime, is still a big unleft. I mean, you know, we accomplished a lot that we set out to do, but that's one that we were not able to fix. We went through four mayors and five police commissioners. I'm pleased that we now have a new state's attorney who sounds like he wants to do something about the violent crime. We got a new U.S. attorney that wants to work together. Hopefully, you know, the city leaders will finally come around, and they still need to pass our legislation that we try to get done for 8 years.
Maryland Governor Larry Hogan, when it comes to education, and this is one of the things that you saw firsthand as the appointment secretary for then Governor Bob Ehrlich, when there was an attempt with Dr. Nancy Grasmick as superintendent to take over 11 schools that were persistently failing our children back in 2005-2006. The Democrats just fought tooth and nail against it, from the mayor to state legislators. You saw that firsthand, but then that came back around again as there was an attempt, just because of R's behind your name, just like with Bob Ehrlich, to deal with those. By the way, those same schools are still failing now 14, 15, 16 years later. Just talk about how the resistance, when people know that there's an issue, just because you have a Republican Party affiliation, it's a blunt to do that in this state.
Well, it's really crazy. It's hard to imagine who would be against fixing persistently failing schools, and who would be against, you know, improving things and giving kids more opportunity. You know, I believe very strongly that every single child deserves access to a world-class education, regardless of what neighborhood they happen to grow up in. And we've taken steps to try to do that. We, again, don't control the local school systems. We provide a lot of money, but can't make their decisions for them. So we record funded education 8 years in a row. And Baltimore City, by the way, is the highest funded in the state. It gets, you know, more than twice as much as any other jurisdiction per pupil. It's the third highest funded school system in America. We have some of the best schools in the country here in Maryland. And we have a couple of good schools in Baltimore. But there are a whole lot of persistently failing schools that are just a mess.
Well, you have grade changing going on. You have ghost students. You have all the things that are underlying this type of dysfunction. And when it's brought to light, if a Democrat was where you are, let's see what Westmore does, I don't think the pushback would be. That's what I'm really bringing up. Just the fact that you're a Republican stopped a lot of things.
That's part of it, maybe. But look, President Obama pushed ESSA, the Every Student Succeeds Act, that was trying to fix the broken schools. The teachers union was opposed to it. It really fixed schools all across the country. It was a good, kind of bipartisan legislation proposed by a Democratic president. Our legislature killed it and voted against more accountability in the schools, voted to make Maryland the least accountable school system in America. So we kept fighting to make those school systems more accountable. They watered down all of our proposals. We did get one thing through. We got an IG appointed that can investigate some of these things, like the ghost students and the grade fixing. But they killed all of the funding and all of the build out of that, so he didn't have all the authority. He has to go asking the state prosecutor or the attorney general or somebody else to help on an investigation. But it has helped uncover some of the problems. We just haven't been able to fix them. But we got to get to the bottom of it. I mean, these parents are very concerned. The students are getting robbed. And it's really the leadership of the school systems that has to be held accountable for all these mistakes, and these kids deserve better.
Meanwhile, on the right, you have now a position where Republicans are actually in worse shape, I think, probably than they have been in quite some time. Most of the people that we've talked to, fellow Republicans and pundits, would agree that Maryland's not in a great shape right now for the Republican Party. Why did it go that way? And do you feel any responsibility? People say you don't have any coattails. What do you say to that?
Well, I would say that's complete nonsense. So in 2014, when I was elected, I had the largest coattails of any governor in the history of the state. And we, for the first time ever, we picked up seats in the Senate. We picked up seats in the House. We five out of the eight county executives for the first time ever were Republicans. We won courthouses and county offices all across the state. I think we turned seven counties from Democrat to Republican. For the first time in history, the majority of all the elected officials in Maryland were Republicans, when you add in all the municipal officials and the county officials. It was a huge accomplishment, and it had never been done before. And then I went and set about raising $10.5 million for the Maryland Republican Party and did everything we could to try to elect more people and get people reelected. The problem was Donald Trump was elected, and Donald Trump cut off of all of those coattails because he lost Maryland by 33 points. And people chose to follow that direction instead of our direction. And so, yeah, the party's a mess in Maryland. The party's a mess across the country. We lost the White House. We lost the Senate. We have a mess going on in the House. We lost governor seats. We lost state legislative bodies. It's not just what happened here. It's very frustrating because we took the party out of the ashes. It was bankrupt and shut down, and they were never going to elect anybody to anything. And we had amazing success. And then it was pretty much ruined with the last election and the one before that. I mean, 2018, I survived, but Republicans were wiped out all over the place because of Donald Trump.
Trump is responsible for losing in Anne Arundel County and Howard County.
No question
County
about
and
that.
Losing.
We did polling in 2018, even though I had a 70-some percent approval, as C4 was talking about.
Yeah,
I still wasn't winning because they were like, I had a high approval rating in the 70s and I had a high favorability rating in the 70s, but I was still underwater in the 40s because 67% of the people in Maryland said, I'm going to vote against every single Republican to send a message to Donald Trump. And they did. I survived, but we lost Alan Kittleman in Howard County, a great county executive. We lost Steve Hsu, a great county executive, in Anne Arundel County. And it persisted again because instead of learning from that lesson, they went back and doubled down on failure. And the party's going to continue to fail, not just in Maryland, but across the country, unless we go in a different direction. And we've kind of already proven the path towards success and how you attract, have a message that appeals to a wider group of people. That's why I ran 45 points ahead of Donald Trump and Dan Cox.
But if you ran a primary in Maryland today, do you think you would beat Donald Trump?
I don't know Donald Trump's going to run or that I'm going to run, but I know I have a 74% approval among Maryland primary voters.
Maryland primary voters, but that's Democrat and Republican.
No, that's just Maryland primary voters.
Just the Republicans. Just the Republicans.
70% with Democrats and 77% with independents. But 74%, I'm very popular. I got the same vote Donald Trump did. I just added to that by winning suburban women by winning over Asian vote, winning Hispanic vote, and getting 30% of the black vote, which no other Republicans ever have been able to do.
Okay, but my point is that the Republican Party is in a place where they are, at least at the statewide level, judging from Dan Cox's primary win, more towards the Trump wing of the party than they are to the Larry Hogan side of the party.
There was about 20% of the people that showed up in the primary. So 20% of the vote in Maryland is Republican. 20% of them show up, so it's about 4% of the people. I think Dan Cox got about 2% of the vote in Maryland. But yeah, it was a mess, and it can't continue, or they're never going to win
anything. But do you think that there should be a place for an open primary?
Absolutely. I've been for open primaries for a long time. I think more people participating in the process is the better. Most states do that now. I think it's 28 states. 14 out of the first 18 primary states in 2024, they're all open primaries. It's not something that we can really control because the people who have the current system, they're the ones that make the decision. So mm-hmm. there's 150 people in the Republican Central Committee and the Democratic Central Committee that make those decisions. It's not the state can't change it. These are party rules, and they want to keep it to the most far left and the most far right, and they don't want to open it up to people that would be more competitive in a general election.
Governor Larry Hogan, when it comes to the pandemic, I mean, like, you begin your experience as governor with a riot in your major city, have to deal with that. And then right towards the end of your service as governor, you have to deal with the first pandemic in 100 years. Talk about just that process and how, you know, it started with like kind of everybody being on board with you, even Democrats, and then it started getting more political as things went forward in terms of some of the decision making. You surround yourself with people from University of Maryland, you know, doctors from there, from Hopkins. I mean, you built a team around you. Talk about that whole experience for a second.
Well, it was something that none of us had ever dealt with. It only happened, 100 years ago. I don't think the federal government or the state government, local government, hospital systems or the private sector in any way were prepared for this. In spite of the fact that we knew that potentially there could be some airborne respiratory virus out there that could be deadly, nobody really, expected it. And we took it very seriously. We were very involved. Not only was I running Maryland, but I was running the National Governors Association. So I had to kind of coordinate with all 50 governors, and I led like 50, 60, Zooms with all the governors, with the president and vice president and all the leaders of the federal government. But we were focused on that every single day, day and night, for 2.5 years, trying to save lives and livelihoods. And it was a major focus. I mean, I had to turn over some of the day-to-day responsibilities of other stuff to the lieutenant governor, who did a great job. And then I focused on the virus. I brought in the smartest people. Both virologists and epidemiologists, public health doctors, but also business leaders, and try to figure out how could we come up with programs, keep businesses alive, keep people paid, and to keep our hospitals from overflowing. We had built an entire infrastructure. We had no testing. We had no vaccines. We had no PPE. It was a massive effort. We had, I think, 11,000 people focused on that day and night, and take my hat off to them. They did a great job. We had one of the best health and economic recoveries in America, and we were rewarded with 86% approval of our handling of the virus, and that was number one in the nation.
So from the left, we hear frequently from our progressive friends that one of the big things that you did that was just so wrong was kill the red line. I mean, constantly, I hear that. It's the root of all problems in Baltimore today. It seems to be the red line. Do you still maintain that it was the right decision? And
absolutely.
If you could, explain why it wasn't worth the investment.
Well, it was a boondoggle that never made any sense whatsoever. I mean, the Washington Post editorial board said it never made any economic or transportation sense. It should have never even been considered. It didn't happen for 8 years under O'Malley for a reason, because it didn't make sense. I ran for governor promising not to do the red line, and Anthony Brown promised to do the red line. The voters voted for me. Most people in Baltimore do not want the red line, and 0% of the people outside of Baltimore want the red line. So it's a handful of, elected officials and activists in Baltimore that love the red line that think it was going to be the end-all, be-all, and they say, if only we had done this, all the problems would have gone away. It was nonsense. It's a train to nowhere. It made no economic sense. It wasn't going to change anything. And so we came in. Our entire transportation department thought it was crazy and that it should not move forward. And,
it was an easy decision for you.
It was an easy decision and one of the best decisions we made. And it also enabled us to, you know, move forward on not only revamping the entire transit system in Baltimore with all the buses, which makes more sense to get people to and from work in and out of the city and go into the neighborhoods, but it also enabled us to invest in, you know, transportation projects in every single jurisdiction in the state. We did top priority projects in every single jurisdiction, and we've invested more in transit and in roads than any governor in history. But yeah, I just did exactly what I said I would do. I remember, I mean, the Washington Post has done 50-some editorials and, you know, probably hundreds of stories where every story is, if only he had built the red line, we wouldn't have crime. And if only he had built the red line, schools would be great and everybody would have jobs. I was in the editorial board meeting during the campaign with all of them sitting around a table. And I said, no, I'm not building the red line. It doesn't make any sense.
Governor Hogan, when it comes to the very beginning of your running, even to this day, you had then Lieutenant Governor Anthony Brown putting out, you know, a campaign material, basically calling you a racist, saying you're going to bring back segregation. If you remember, I actually talked with him on air about that and challenged him at the time with those type of aspersions. Then you have the former head of the Democratic Party in our state, the widow of Congressman Elijah Cummings, basically calling you a white supremacist. Just if you can talk about just throughout your service, regardless of what you had done, you're just an overall Republican racist, according to some.
Well, you know, I just sort of ignored all that stuff. I remember when Anthony Brown first attacked me, you came on there and I think defended that and said you'd known me for years and you knew I was not a racist.
But the fact that I actually had to defend that, though.
Look, the proof is in the pudding, and, you know, actions matter more than words, and I think I've proven that's absolutely false. And, I want to keep talking about approval ratings, but, you know, every single demographic, we're over 70, but our highest demographic today, job approval in Maryland, is black voters.
What does that tell you?
Which is 80%. So 8 out of 10 black voters do not think I'm a racist. They think I was a great governor. And I think the fact that we came and kept people safe in the city of Baltimore, the fact that we've been fighting to try to improve the schools, the fact that I want to get tough on the violent criminals that are making them afraid to be in their own neighborhoods, those are not, you know, maybe far left Democratic talking points, but they're what resonates. I think, you know, I talk to people all the time to come up to me, African-American voters and Marylanders who say, I don't even agree with you on everything, but I voted for you because I think you care, and I think you're trying your best to solve the problems. And I think, you know, somebody else said to me, a black guy who came up to me and said, you know, I think I know what the secret is. He said, you know, black people, they don't like a lot, they can see through a lot of BS, and they think that your guy just tells it like it is. And I think that resonates with a lot of people, but you know, I think we've done extremely well. I got a higher vote than any elected Republican for any office anywhere in the country, probably in history. So I would say the people that were saying that were, again, dead wrong.
Misinformed.
Yeah. Misinformed.
So the question has to be asked, are you going to Iowa, New Hampshire? Are you going to run for president?
Well, I've been to Iowa, and I'm telling you what, one of the best things, you know, that the Iowa State Fair is unbelievable. Uh-huh. It's huge. And they got pork chop on a stick, which is,
you know, I saw you with that thing.
It's pretty good. So I might have to go back there again. But we've been to New Hampshire 3 or 4 times. I've been to 24 states in addition to, you know, closing out strong here in Maryland. I've been to all 24 jurisdictions in Maryland also. And we keep, you know, we're leaving it all on the field here, finishing out. But pretty soon, January 18th, they're going to, you know, throw me out on the streets, and right. I'm going to have something to do. So. Right. Maybe I'll get a chance to do a little more traveling, and a lot of people have been encouraging me to consider that, but I really have not made any decisions in that regard.
I know Mitch McConnell tried to get you to run for Senate. Were you close at all?
Never close. A lot of people were trying to get me to do that. I mean, I had both, Rick Scott and his committee and Mitch McConnell and his committee. I had Mitch's wife, Elaine Chao, was lobbying my wife, and, we had calls from all our supporters and donors and people all over the country. Trying to get me, and every single time, I never once led them on. I was like, thank you, I'm flattered, I appreciate the interest, but I have no interest whatsoever and being a U.S. senator.
Well, there's a 10-2 time slot open right here at WBL.
If I can come I can fill in.
Our program
for Bryan
director's right outside someplace. You want to talk? Mike is right out there.
I could be a guest host once in a while when you guys are sick or something.
We'd love for you to come in. I'm open invitation.
That'd be great. But yeah, the Senate is. There was a Senate leadership poll and a Washington Post poll. Both showed me beating Van Hollen by 12 points. And, of course, they wanted to take the Senate back. So from their standpoint, it'd be great for having me run. But I just didn't think that job was right for me. I'm not a legislator. I can't see spending my whole day arguing with 99 other people and getting nothing done. I take actions every day that impact people's lives, and I like running things.
I'll let you have the last word, is that do you see yourself in the Republican Party from here on out? Do you ever see yourself leaving it?
Look, I'm a dedicated Republican since I was a little kid. I was a teenage Republican, college Republican, president of Young Republicans, chairman of Youth for Reagan. I've been fighting for the party my whole life. I'm not going anywhere. I'm going to do everything I can to get the party back to the kind of party that I believe in.
Well, finally, Maryland Governor Larry Hogan, I said from the very beginning when you were sworn in and sat behind this mic, I am biased when it comes to talking about you because you are a friend, have been a friend, will be a friend in the future. And I just want you to know from me that I am proud of your service over the last 8 years. And that's the way I'd like to conclude my discussion with you at this juncture. And then we'll talk in the future.
Well, thank you very much, C4. And thank you, Bryan. And
before I leave, it's the 100th anniversary of WBAL Radio.
Oh,
so
wow.
I have a governor's citation.
Oh, man. Oh, my goodness. Well, we got to get a picture together with you for that.
I know, Bryan, you haven't been here for 100 years. C4.
This gray hair will tell
give
you
the
that.
Give me the C4. He deserves it more than I do.
He's been here for half of it.
Very good.
Thank you so much, my friend. I got it. There we go. Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you, Governor.
Thank you, Governor, for coming in. We appreciate it.
Yeah, let me just say, I really appreciate C4. When I started Change Maryland, you were the only guy that would talk to me 12 years ago, and he actually let me come in and talk about taxes and all this, and you're still talking to me, so
I'm
I appreciate you guys. Thank you very much.
God bless you, guys.
Great to have you. Best of luck.
Care.